Okay, we are live, and our guest tonight is Professor Patricia Haseltine of Providence University in Taiwan. Welcome.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for asking me to come on your program. I've been watching your program, and I find some very interesting things in it. You have several, right? You have one in art, and then you have one for Bo, and then you have one for yourself, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, actually, the Bo channel started out my channel, and obviously I was doing research with Bo, so I shared that. And for some reason, some aspect of my interactions with Bo really fascinated certain people. And so that it kind of like Bo took over the channel. Yeah, so I have some minor channels, one for art and one for literature. But this is my main channel, which is actually the Bo channel that we're on.
Oh, we're on the Bo channel today. Well, that's great.
Yeah, it's my main channel. Yes, because we're going to be talking about animal motifs,
right,
in literature. How did you choose that as your topic?
Well, I've been interested in this for a long, long time. Actually, when I was studying for my master's degree, I got in touch with some Chinese stories from the Feng Sheng Bang, and then I got into some other interesting things in Chinese culture, and from there, I of course was reading Ovid. Ovid has a lot of interesting metamorphoses and sort of this going from animal to human back and forth. People who are transformed are women transformed into animals, which is a kind of a victim age. This of course has other implications that people can talk about. But from Ovid and from these ancient Chinese stories or the Ming Dynasty stories, I came to Taiwan. And when I came to Taiwan, some people were telling me stories about a fox spirit.
Oh, wow.
And so I started to collect those tales. And over the years, I've been translating them. That was back in the 70s, around 1970, 75, 76, that time. So the people that I collected these stories from were from the mainland, mostly from Shandong.
Oh, yeah. Really?
Yeah. And so they they told me a lot of interesting stories. And then I got in, I found this work called Liao Zai. Liao Zai is one of the kind of classics of works which were taken from folklore, and then this person Pu Songling wrote down these stories. So most of those were kind of fox spirit stories. So from there, I just kind of got into it and started to study these. And then recently, of course, we have the sort of ecological interest in animals and letting them survive, sort of finding ways to make sure that they don't become extinct. So I use that now in my composition classes. Last semester, students were writing their own stories about animals which were endangered in one way or another. So it's always been kind of an interest. I'm not an expert in any of these things, but it's an interest that I still have. And I'm still doing the translations of those stories that I want.
You're a bit of a folklorist in that case, that you actually talk to the people and find out what their stories are.
Yes. Uh-huh. As a folklorist, what we usually do is kind of a field work.
Yeah.
And my early field work was in the drama, in Taiwan. Maybe when you were in Taiwan for a while, did you see some of the dramas on the street?
Not on the street. Yes. I didn't actually go to a theater or anything, but yeah, I saw some street ones.
Well, the ones that I was interested in too were the ones on the street. Yeah. Because I thought that, you know, that's a folk art for these people who were telling it. And at that time, they couldn't go into the there were movies, but there were not too many onstage performances. So it was mostly outside. Now it's all in the, you know, in very formal situations, and in the nice good stage, and you know, very very nice surroundings. But in those days, people would just come and they'd bring their stools and things from the from home and sit around and watch the street plays.
Yeah. Now, were most of the plays in Mandarin, or some of them in Hakka?
Yes. Well, they had different topics, and during the day, they were a little bit more formal, kind of influenced by Chinese opera and the history, you know, Chinese history. But in the evening, they were very loose, and the directors were making up their own stories. Of course, they were kind of influenced,
yes,
by the form. You know, they couldn't really go outside of that form of the actual roles, but they were making up their own stories, and you know, this was they would be in the native language of Taiwanese rather than in Mandarin.
Right.
And during that time, Mandarin was not allowed to be spoken in the classrooms. So this was something that was on the street for the people to enjoy.
You mean Taiwanese was not allowed, right?
Yes. Taiwanese was not allowed in the schools. Right?
Yeah.
But of course, everybody at home was speaking it.
Yes.
And so, in the folk, folklore, there was still a lot of transmission, what we call transmission, in various ways.
Mm-hmm. Now you have a number of slides. Would you like me to attempt to share those right now?
Okay.
All right, well, we'll see what happens. Are you seeing anything at all?
No.
Okay.
Let's see here. okay. You want me to try from here? Or?
Okay, why don't you?
Okay, so where do I go from here?
let me try again, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to the screen share thing, and I'm going to the place where it says that I want to share the entire screen. This is where I'm getting a little bit stuck because I'm not able to get my mouse and click on the share. Okay, I'm going to say share system audio. And
okay, well, we can just talk about it. We don't need to.
Okay, do you see anything at all? Okay, hold on. I really would like to be able to do this. it's just that. Okay, we have a comment from Haley Rond, Haley Durand. For some reason, I wanted to share at least that. Okay, so I'm going to cancel it. Would you like to see Haley's comment? She says, "The wonders of modern technology, nothing here." Okay, let me try again. It's I'm having a problem with my mouse. That's what's happening. So I'm telling it to go ahead and share. And I am sharing my screen. And
okay,
now,
there you go. There you go.
Infinite regress. Do you see it now?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
So let me go ahead and put that into the slideshow so that we don't see the stuff on the side.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Is this the correct slideshow or correct
yes.
slide?
Uh-huh. Yes. Uh-huh. We can start at the beginning there.
So are
okay.
we...
So what we'll be talking about here are the conduits for the stories. And we know that stories about animals are very widespread around the world. And especially the fables have been translated into many different languages. So fables, of course, are the most common. We know that the people who transmit these are mostly the traders and people like soldiers and sailors who go from one part of the earth to another. And of course, during the wars, there was a lot of interchange between different cultures, and the missionaries too were responsible. For writing down many of these stories. So we have all of these different people kind of are conduits for this transmission of stories across different borders. So the common role distinctions in these, of course, we have different stories. We have myths and folktales and fables and legends. Those are the main genres that we're usually interested in. in folklore. And of course, the myths, most of the animals in the myths are adversaries. You think of Hercules and having to conquer all of these different creatures. And of course, the victims. So the victims of different struggles. But they're also tricksters, especially in the Native American cultures and in Taiwan and other places. You have the trickster characters. And these are usually animals, but they can transform sometimes into other types of creatures.
Are we talking about Austronesian culture also in Taiwan?
Yes, we have different transformations happen there too. In some of the Austronesian cultures. So Taiwan, of course, most of the indigenous people here, the indigenous people are associated with the larger Austronesian cultures. And maybe they spread from many of these cultural aspects were spread as the people went to the different islands in the Pacific. So the Pacific Ocean was a main place of transmission of Austronesian culture and language, of course. Mm-hmm. Language is what we can usually study now. You know, you're a linguist.
Yes.
Of course, some of the words that are found in Taiwan for various things, like a chicken, I think, have traveled all across the Pacific and even as near as Hawaii. So the language has been there, and of course some of the stories, but we haven't really been able to collect that many and make too many comparisons yet. But besides the myths, we have folk tales, of course. And in the folk tales, you have helpers usually. So in the early part of the tales, we have a donor, and this donor sometimes is an animal spirit. In the Cinderella story, for instance, after her mother died, she became a cow, and in the cow is giving Cinderella help in the very beginning part of this tale. So that's probably a good example of the donor animal. And this, of course, is related. She's related to her daughter. The cow is related to the daughter.
Mm-hmm.
The fables are something which are very, very different, of course. In the fables, we have a moral or a power relationship, and these are very ancient. A lot of them came to us probably from India or Greece, and those fables were originally written for kings and their sons to train them to be good leaders. So to give them, the values that they need to be in power. So then we have the legends, and the legends, what I was talking about before, these are about these transformations of animals to human beings. And here we have some gender situations, which are very interesting to study. And then we have saints' legends. Things like Saint Francis of Assisi and his friendship with the wolves, and this way of changing the behavior of the animals is very interesting in those stories. But in children's literature, we have a lot of different variations. This definition I think is very interesting from Edmund Leach, who was a linguist, right? And he has this idea that the physical and the social environment of a young child is perceived as a continuum. In the cultural and social differentiation that you have there, the Chinese animals you just showed, right? Okay. The Chinese animals. So we have the Chinese animals used to differentiate the different human beings. And this is, of course, by your birth year. So you've encountered this before, haven't you? This
This
scale. Yeah, I've asked students whether they really, you know, whether this is really important in their life, and some of them say yes. At their birth, it was important to distinguish, make this distinction. And when they marry, when they get married, it's best to find someone who is compatible according to the Chinese astrology. Mm-hmm. So the animal year or the birth year is important. But this, of course, is just, it's like the fable. It's something which is used to differentiate people. And just like in Native American culture, you differentiate according to clans. And you have the bear clan or the snake clan and different animals. So we have these, what an interesting tale is this emergence from the egg. That's the one right before, Aya, if you go right, that's the right. So in this one, you can see we have distinctions of gender here and the separation of the social classes. So in one version, they're talking about this 100-pacer snake is protecting the first man within the egg, right? It doesn't say that it's a snake's egg. So, but probably in some versions originally, it could have been a snake's egg, which is a very interesting question. But the 100-pacer snake here in the middle, you see the diamond markings pretty clearly in this picture. And you see the diamond markings also on the statue, on the carved statue on the right. Mm-hmm. And this is very important in the Paiwan culture because it has to do with the royalty. And we also have it's just the idea of the male and the female. So the 100-pacer snake, why do they call it the 100-pacer snake? The idea is that if you get bitten by one of these snakes, you probably can only go about 100 paces before you succumb to the poison. Mm. So it's a very poisonous snake, but it's also revered. And as you can see in these two stories, one says that it protects the nobles, and in the other, it says it protects the male. So this is a very interesting contrast, I think, in this Paiwan story. Paiwan group is in the southern part of Taiwan.
Well, it contrasts very much with the Garden of Eden story and a snake.
Yes. Uh-huh. So it's a very interesting contrast that we have here.
Yeah. So should I move forward now?
Okay. Now let's go on here to the animal roles In the traditional stories, the donors, I talked about the Cinderella. Of course, the mice also help Cinderella, right? And the horse as helper. In many of the traditional stories, all over Europe especially, you have the horse is an important human helper, right? Or also a vehicle, of course.
The thing is that horses really do. I mean, you know, if a man is drunk and he's driving a car, he's not going to do very well. But it used to be that a horse would carry a drunk man home. So,
right. That's a good example. Yeah, they depend completely in that case on the animal.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, and in many of the epics too, we have in the Ramayana, for instance, is a very good example of the vehicle of the different animals being able to carry the characters.
Mm-hmm.
In the traditional stories, of course, they're gods. So Hanuman is the monkey god in Hindu culture, and in the Ramayana, and he's able to fly to many different places very quickly. He goes up into the Himalayas and he gets an herb which brings people back to life, and helping in many different ways. The main hero, Rama. The Ramayana has many of these basic motifs in it.
Mm-hmm.
But we also have allegorized human beings, right? Like in the fables, the fox and the cock, for instance. Mm-hmm. These are, as I said, were moral stories. Let's go on to number three now, Aya. Yeah.
Okay. Here we are.
Yeah. So liminality, I think, is very interesting here, because liminality means it's not stable. It can go from one side to the other. So we have a species liminality, what we have in these stories. And they can change. The characters change. Some of them are changing in order to seduce a human being. So it's kind of interesting that in Greek culture, of course, we have in Ovid, we have the raping and this kind of problem involved in these transformations. But in the Asian stories, in the Chinese stories, you have a seductress as a fox spirit, for instance. And you can see here that this character in the stories is appearing sometimes as a human being and sometimes as a fox or a snake or some other being. And so one of the interesting things about these stories is that you're looking for, people are trying to find out the truth of this character. So maybe they can use a mirror, and they use the mirror to find out, what this person's original form was. So I've always thought it's kind of interesting too that we have the witch in the stories in who's the most beautiful of all in the West, and so this is also a mirror is there, and so maybe it has other connotations from what we usually think.
Well, the story of Narcissus also has a mirror in it. But
yes, the mirror image of Narcissus. Yes.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And the echo idea is there too. So this kind of a reflection. Mm-hmm. That's one of the interesting things about these transformation stories. There are so many questions we can ask about them. And the Narcissus, of course, has also been investigated by many psychologists.
Oh, yes, recently. That's a very popular topic.
Yes, uh-huh. So we have Freud's early investigations into narcissism, and then we have Derrida and a few other people. I have a student who did some interesting work on some movies with the narcissist theme. Yes, it's very important. Okay, and then we come down to, okay, the problem here in Ovid, for instance, is that you have Zeus taking on many forms in order to be with a woman. You have, or also Athena and Arachne. Yeah, you know, Arachne wanted to compete with Athena in her weaving. And she shouldn't have done that.
So, well, that's hubris, isn't it?
Yes. So she becomes a snake, not a snake, a spider, right?
Spider, yeah.
Yeah, so Arachne as kind of the spider image is also this kind of a victim of the transformation. We also have the tempters of the mermaids.
Yes.
As kind of a hybridic figure. So they tempt the people along the coast, for instance. But in the story by Anderson, she becomes more friendly, not such a threat. So these are interesting stories too, the mermaids and the different versions of the mermaid.
Yeah, I think in time, all of these stories become more romanticized. The ancient forms are a little bit more cruel.
Yes, during the Romantic period, you know, all of these characters kind of became something else. They became, yeah. You know, there's more sympathy for them.
Mm-hmm.
They're accepted for their differences. It's
right.
Kind of interesting.
Uh-huh. Well, and the same thing with vampires, really. The story of vampires are also kind of like half bat, half
right,
human.
Right. So this was a big change in the historical view of animals, and it's kind of interesting. Maybe it came along with after the Enlightenment too, because the Enlightenment started to look at things and question some of those traditional ideas and concepts.
Well, yeah, that's true and good. Milton had views of the devil that were not entirely unsympathetic to.
Right, right. So during the Middle Ages, of course, the devil was an important figure. But later on, there were many different ways of, explaining it. And now we think of it as something in psychology rather than some kind of transformation. the devil was transformed into a dog. Yeah, so the dog and transformation is involved with that figure. But in religion, too, we have reincarnation. Okay, as reincarnation is another relationship, of course, that we have with the animal, different animals. So we have Jataka tales in India, which are Buddhist tales, and those are really very, very interesting. Maybe we could go down to So this Lady White Snake is in the operas. And in many of the different stories, And she has so many different features. She's when you really think about it, she's helping the hero of the white snake story. He falls in love with her, and he marries her. They have a baby, right? But okay. She's supernatural, right? She's a snake, right? And so she's been condemned to this role, and to being a snake. And she wants to, of course, eventually become a human. But here she is still in the mode of tempting somebody. But she also steals some herbs from heaven to give to this her husband. So the Buddhist monk is Fahai is against her, right, and has to oppose her. So it becomes a struggle between her and the religious aspect. So it's a battle ensues between her and all of her scions and the Buddhist monk. So it has kind of a sad ending. She has to go back and be punished, but the husband has a child to take care of. And so that's giving us kind of a hope for the future. You have different endings to this story too. So just like you said, you know, in the West, things like the devil were changed. Here, this change has also taken place, so that we have different versions, and the white snake is more and more friendly, more and more not a threat, but mm-hmm. someone who is suffering. And her relationship with the man is helping her find love in this world. So, you know, you have a big change in Chinese culture as well. Let's go on to the next slide. Uh-huh. Okay, this is from the Ramayana. And here we have the vulture, or some people see him as an eagle, but he tries to save Rama's wife, Sita, and from the bad king, Ravana. But this vulture is fairly old, and he is unable to really save her, but he can tell Rama where she is and gone to the island of Ravana. So this idea of change or transformation in reincarnation comes here, because in the future Jatayu will not be in the animal kingdom anymore. So this idea of different lives is implied. Okay. So there's basically a contrast here, a change too, from the ancient, really the ancient text of in Hinduism. Animals were sacrificed. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. They were sacrificed to the gods.
Yes.
And the goddesses. And this was for the good of people to sacrifice these animals. And horses, too, were part of this sacrifice in the ancient Vedas. But and it was kind of also a symbolic act to do this, to tame the natural forces. But in the Tathagatas and in the later Buddhism, we have this opposition to a sacrifice. Right? So this is a major change too, right?
Right. I mean, actually, from the Vedas to Buddhism, it's a really big revolution, because it almost feels like a change from polytheism to some kind of unified a theory of godhood. Do you think so?
Mm-hmm. Very, very different, right? So in the Jatakas, we have these stories of the Buddha going through different phases. Maybe he's a lion or a deer in a different life. And so, you know, the Buddha is these animals and is in the role of these animals and or human beings, other human beings. But he does good things and then, of course, is able to improve his reincarnation. But there's also self-sacrifice in the Buddhist stories. And also a Buddhist interpretation is that the animal will have a liberation.
Okay, but liberation actually happens after after one's individuality is merged with the universe, right?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. So this animal does something good. There's a story about a lion and a little rabbit, and the little rabbit hears a mango fall from a tree. He's a little baby rabbit, and this mango falls from the tree. So he's very nervous and he's scared. And he tells the other rabbits, you know, the earth is falling in. We're doomed. And then those rabbits tell the other animals. And pretty soon all the animals are all afraid and they're all sort of going toward, they're running away, and they run toward a cliff. The lion sees them running in that direction. He says, "What in the world is happening?" So he goes to scare them so that they won't go over the cliff.
Mm-hmm.
And so he does them a service. And he says, "Well, what's all this about? Why are you so nervous? And why is all this going on?" So they say, "Well, we heard this little rabbit tell us that the world is doomed." And so he goes, he says, "Well, why did this little rabbit think that?" Then he goes to the tree and he sees the mango that fell from the tree. And he said, "Oh, this is not, you know, just because he's a little animal, right? He thought that this was a major catastrophe, but it wasn't." And so the lion was able to save all of these creatures, which were just about to go over the cliff. So that's the lion is one of the incarnations of Buddha. Mm-hmm. And so he has saved all of these little animals.
Yeah. Well, predators actually need the prey. So there is kind of a circle of life.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, certainly. And so this the relationships with everybody, and including the animals, everything is connected.
Yes.
Yeah. So these stories are really very, very nice. The volume that I have here.
Perhaps I'll stop sharing so I can see you.
Okay. Maybe you can see this. It's called The Hungry Tigress. as told here by Raff Martin. This is the Parallax Press in Berkeley, California. So this is a very interesting English version of the Jataka tales.
Wow, very nice. We do actually have some comments. I will go ahead and share those. So Julia's Hair Journey says, oh yes, the trickster and the coyote.
Yes, the coyote is very, very interesting because he's, you know, we have the Milky Way. Okay, he's a creator too. Besides being, you know, seducing women and things like that, he's also in the creator field. And so he creates the Milky Way. You know, they had, in the beginning, you have all of these stars are being placed in the sky. And he's too impatient. The coyote is impatient. So he goes and takes all of these stars and just throws them up. And so that's how we get the Milky Way. Okay.
And she says, oh, we'll leave.
Yeah, train horses.
Yeah, that would solve a lot of problems.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be a good idea.
Haley has something to say. She says, Haley says, I enjoy the trickster tales, but I have a love for the fox stories.
Yes.
Yeah, Haley is a great lover of foxes.
Yes. Uh-huh. The fox can just be anything, right?
Yeah.
You have a fox story too.
Yeah. I now have it in both English and Hebrew in case there's a fox.
Yes. It's very interesting what you did with that story. So the fox doesn't appear, right?
Well, he doesn't appear
mystery.
In, you know, the little girl and the hound do not see the fox. But if you look in the pictures, the fox is hiding. So he's actually there. You just never get, he never appears in such a way that the little girl can see him.
That's fascinating the way you did that. Yeah, I like that that idea. It's a little bit like that transformation. You know, you can't see it, but you know it's there.
Right, and you see that they're asking the hares. They're asking them, "Have you seen the fox?" And the hares won't snitch. You know, I mean, that's one interpretation. Of course, maybe they can't talk, but they're on the side of the fox, even though the fox is chasing them. They are not going to turn the fox in to the human.
Right, right. So the child's curiosity is nurtured by that story. Yeah, yeah. I like that. Yeah. Okay, we have any other comments from outside? Or
well, Haley said wonderful, but I don't know about. Yeah.
Okay. So, you want to go back to the
slide? So shall we go back to the same slide? You had two parts. Shall we do the second part now?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So let me see if I do this a little bit faster this time.
Mm-hmm.
Share screen.
Okay. So the two parts, the animal sacrifice as the here.
Animal motifs, part two.
Okay.
Can you see it?
Okay. All right.
And
do you want to go to, okay. So did you want to do the
slideshow? Yeah, I will.
The later part of the first one? The first one, we still didn't do the...
Oh, we didn't. Okay. All right. So let me...
Maybe we could just go through this.
Okay. Let me go back and
well, we
find
already
the
talked
first
about
one.
The Romantic period. So
right.
Yeah.
All right. Slideshow.
Maybe
and
you could go to the Beatrice Potter part.
Okay. Let me see where that is. So is
just
this
go
too
down.
Far?
Mm-hmm. Just keep back, going back. Down.
Okay.
Yeah, we talked about the Romantic period already, and the dragon we know from Musu, that's changed a lot. Okay, so we have the animals in Beatrice Potter's tales, right? Mm-hmm. Those are very interesting. The one about these animals, some of them are eaten, right?
Yeah.
So. So she's very realistic in that aspect.
You know, but if you say that a rabbit and a pig are eaten, but a hedgehog and a frog aren't, it really
yeah.
depends. If you're French, you might eat the frog.
Yeah, right, right. Yeah. So, the pig goes to market is not a very good idea. So, because the pig might become something to eat.
Well, that reminds me of Charlotte's Web, you know, where they dealt with that issue.
Right. Yeah. So she's able to keep these habits of the animals in so that we can see, you know, some of the basic habits that they have. So even though she makes them more humorous in a way, I like. Yeah. Do you? Have you read her stories?
Mm-hmm. Yes, but I'm not over and over again. I also saw a movie about her, Miss Potter.
Oh, uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. There are different videos about her as well. But they usually wear clothes, right?
Yeah.
So. Like human beings do. So many of these 19th century writers, British writers, you know, they seem to have kind of a conflict. On the one hand, they want to make them more human, and they wear clothes and speak in different ways and have interesting friendships like humans do. But on the other hand, they're being very scientific because they're kind of looking at the environment that these characters are in. And
she did the illustrations, didn't she? She didn't just write it, but she also drew it.
Right, right. She's able to do that. Yeah, to be able to get out, where they actually live in the garden or wherever.
Right.
Yeah. So she as I think this type of a conflict, sort of between trying to be more scientific, but also, sort of making them like human beings. So, but they're interesting stories, fascinating.
What okay. sort of what sort of examples have you studied of understatement and innuendos in the books? Because I actually am not that familiar.
Yeah. So one of the innuendos is that when the pig goes to market, it starts out as kind of an innuendo, sort of like your idea of the fox. So you're wondering, you know, exactly, you know, how this is going to turn out. But pretty soon she reveals the idea, well, it's not a good idea for those pigs to be in the marketplace.
Mm.
She's kind of suggesting it in the beginning, and then toward the end, it becomes clear they better get away. So they use a trickster sort of way of, pretending in order to get away from the human beings who are going to cook them. So she kind of plays with our imagination in that way. And So that's what I mean by kind of the innuendo, the understatement. Yeah. And let's go to Rudyard Kipling now, if we can.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see.
Okay.
Well, so a little bit further.
The next one. Uh-huh. Yeah, in Kipling's Just So Tales are fascinating, I think.
Yeah, I actually have a copy of them here. I don't know if you can see me holding it up, but I do.
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, it's he does so many different things in each tale, right?
Yeah.
For the folklorist, we look at it and we say, well, he's sort of playing games with this idea of the etiology, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So he's saying, well, this is the origin of the hump for the camel.
Yeah.
Right? Or this is the origin of the skin of the rhinoceros. So,
but it's very Lamarckian in its evolutionary. Right.
So these are also very false origins,
right?
Yeah. So I noticed that some people have talked about his being is playing games with this Lamarckian view.
Mm-hmm.
Lamarck in biology was a French biologist, and he said that if you change a trait in an animal or a human being, then the next generation will be able to carry that trait. But this was kind of a debate, sort of in the whole evolutionary idea. So people are still experimenting with this question of, can traits be handed down from generation to generation? So the hump of the camel, he gives the, how did camels get a hump? So in this case, the jinn, the magic in the desert, he's, because he doesn't do any work, then he has to get a hump. And this is by magic in the desert. And so eventually then he has to work very hard after that as a punishment. So he starts out with the etiology, but he's also sort of parodying the idea of Lamarck had of, the origin of some particular characteristic like the hump.
Well, it turns out that DNA doesn't work in a Lamarckian way. DNA is more Darwinian, but there are certain aspects of RNA that sort of vindicate Lamarck.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. So you've taught Bo many different things to do. Yeah. So it'd be kind of interesting to know, if some of those things that he does can be transmitted by him to another creature, to another.
Well, I mean, if he had offspring and got to raise them, then that would be cultural transmission, not genetic transmission.
Right. Right. Yeah. So I think that's kind of what Kipling is getting to. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sort of, that by playing these games. Of course, his games are also linguistic.
Yes.
So he kind of uses language to do that too.
The camel is actually called a camel because he's been weaned of water. That's what gamal means in the Semitic languages.
Right. Yeah. Also, he wants the moral. He wants to make it a moral story.
Yes.
At the end, like a fable.
Yes.
Yeah. So he kind of, so many different genres are combined. So he's very creative in doing that.
I love that painting of Kipling. Do you know who painted him?
No.
It's very nice.
Yeah. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you want to talk about The Jungle Book and Kim?
Well, let's see. The story, the last story in the Just So stories is kind of interesting. Because this has what in semiotics we call, that'd be the next slide.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. I was going to look at the actual book. Okay.
Yeah. Hayoiga, then the next one.
Yeah. Okay. Hayoiga.
Yeah. Hayo. Okay. Yeah. He has all these characteristics of the animals. Yeah. And so the parodying the creation stories and all of those. So you used his Rikki Tikki in your novel, right?
Yes, I did. In Our Lady of Kaifeng, the second half, Courtyard of the Happy Way.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah. So basically, rather than reading her daughter stories from the Bible, she, Mara, read her daughter about Rikki Tikki Tavi, and that kind of became a religion for Sybil, the little girl.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah. So the little girl was very interested in this. It's also kind of a gruesome story of, you know, the battle between the snakes.
Yeah, but Rikki Tikki Tavi is a protector, but mm-hmm. they live in a treacherous world in which, you know, the snakes are going after not just the humans, but the bird eggs and everything. And so that aspect of Kipling is very realistic.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. So he's showing the cruelty that's involved. Also, you can just kind of, you know, we had a person here living in Donghai University, and uh-huh. it has a lot of trees. They said there were snakes in the houses. So that's a very realistic aspect.
Oh, no, I've had snakes show up in my house as well.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
You know, and I don't kill them because they're not dangerous to me. They're black rat snakes.
Uh-huh.
And uh-huh. so I just take a pair of tongs and I transport them outside where they can do what they need to do.
Yeah, if you can get them outside, that's the important thing.
Right.
Yeah. But do they take care of the rats, though?
Yeah, they take care of the rats and the mice because, you know, I live in, I'm surrounded by nature. And nature yes. tries to get into the house. It really does.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Yeah, I've seen some of your pictures about the snakes that you see there. Yeah.
Yeah.
So are some of them poisonous?
Not the ones that I found. That's why I'm not, you know, I wasn't terrified to find them, and I'm not, you know, the ones that I can see are not dangerous to humans at all.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. So, do you want to go on to the other part, or would you like to do it another day?
I'd be happy to. Just so we're ready for part two, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Hold on.
Okay.
What we have to do is open up part two. This is part two, right? And
okay.
Slide.
I have mine on here too, so that I can see everything. So the fox, we've already kind of talked about the idea of the fox in Aesop. Of course, he's playing games. Also, the idea he wants the grapes. The fox and the grapes is an interesting story. But this is an interesting problem of teaching children or teaching young people that they shouldn't you know, use flattery, or they shouldn't be too proud. And also the idea of sour grapes is something, a kind of a deeper idea.
I think that in today's psychology, people are actually trained to do the sour grape thing, where if you apply for a job and you don't get the job, then you say, oh, well, it probably wouldn't have suited me, or I wouldn't have liked it, so it's not so bad, you know.
Right.
Or in a situation where somebody courts somebody else and they're not successful, then they're actually encouraged to have sour grapes about that.
Yeah.
Don't you think so?
So it's psychologically, it has an effect to make you feel better.
Right. Right.
About losing something.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. So we could see him as a very positive example.
Right. I think there's a difference between the ancient way in which that was looked askance at. You know, the ancient values were you should be truthful and you shouldn't pretend that you don't want something just because you didn't get it.
Yes. Uh-huh.
But the modern view is if you want to be psychologically whole, you need to find a way to make yourself feel good about how things turned out.
Yeah, right. So a way to ameliorate the embarrassment.
Right.
Of it. Yeah. Uh-huh. Is that in Chaucer and some of the medieval stories, the fox is more of a trickster.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
So we talked about the transformations before. The fox is a seducer in many of the stories. Let's go to the monkey god now, okay? Okay, Hanuman. So he's really a fascinating figure, I think. Chinese stories are, it's kind of hard. Maybe Hanuman is somehow a transmission to our Monkey King in China too. So, but you also have native people in the south, in Fujian and places like that in the past, who also had worshipped kind of a monkey god. But, you know, the relationship between India and China is very complicated over the ages. And so it's kind of the Hanuman figure maybe is kind of been transmitted. We don't know. But he's an incarnation, right? He was supposed to be learning things on the earth and to be ascetic. He became an immortal. His godfather was the wind. You know, this wind idea he was in his birth is important. And then in the Rama story, he's very interesting because he's the friend. And some versions show him to show the love that he has for Rama, a very emotional relationship. He's also a general in that story. So he plays many roles, right? And of course, you have temples in India devoted to him still today. So have you read about this Hanuman figure before? Or
I've heard of him. I can't say that I've read a lot about him, but I mean, he sounds quite familiar.
Yeah,
the Hare Krishnas used to, I think they used to share some of that.
The Ramayana is a very interesting epic.
Yeah,
has several different versions in translation. So, in Hindi and Sanskrit and other languages. So it's you can see that people have also interpreted this figure in different ways. Let's go on to the Chinese monkey god or monkey king, right? In the Shiyoji, or the Journey to the West by Wu Cong'an, is an epic. And in this epic, these travelers are going to get the Buddhist scriptures from India. The monk here is taking all of these other animals with him. So this is a kind of a different relationship between the animals as friends on a journey, and they protect him in different ways because they have different ways of fighting off enemies or dealing with nature. And so they're able to help out, but they also have their weaknesses. The monkey himself has, stole things from heaven. Was being punished, and he's always doing things that he shouldn't do. And so they give him a band to put around his head, and whenever he does something he shouldn't do, then it gets tighter. Yeah. So this is kind of a control over this very ingenuous character. But he's probably one of the smartest on this journey, and able to see them through many of their difficulties. The pig is also interpreted in different ways, and Buddhists, of course, see him as insatiable creature. One who is only looking for his own comfort and eats too much and things like that. And then this other monster is also learning to be better, right? So they're all trying to get rid of their weaknesses or they're trying to become better in this journey.
Who is this person here with the beard and the blue outfit in the back?
Yeah, so the one in the back is the Jubajie. He's the pig.
He's the pig. Okay.
Yeah, the one between the monk and the pig is this Sandy, and Sandy comes from. Sort of his origin here in the Flowing Sands River. He became a monster, and then he was sort of taken out of the river and in order to become better. He used to eat people when they tried to cross the river. Right? And so he's being trained to be better too. So this is... I don't think he's an animal exactly. He's more some kind of hybrid monster creature. Okay, but Sun Wukong is has so many different transformations that he can use. So this is this idea of transformation coming out again. The snake, story. Here we can talk a little bit about the snake now.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know. Maybe you can see this here. Yeah. So this is a very interesting book, a kind of a retelling.
Oh, are you trying to show me something? In that case, I will go out of screen share.
Well, maybe so. Okay.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Hold on.
Yeah. This is what's interesting about this book is that it kind of combines. No, the drawings in the book are made according to the drama, right? So it's kind of interesting that they did kind of combine. This is the lady snake and her maid. Her maid is green snake. Right? And so then they come together here at the Western Lake.
These are beautiful illustrations. I love them.
Yes, they are. They are very beautiful. This is done by Aaron Shepherd is the one who rewrote the story. And the illustrations are by Song Nan Zhang or Zhang Song Nan. So it's an interesting volume. Shepherd came to one of our conferences in children's literature to Taiwan. So mm-hmm. he gave me this this volume. It's very beautiful. But the lady snake has been in different translations too, and I made a comparison here between them, and in that comparison we can see that in the German version it's a kind of romanticizes the characters, but in the other one it just takes the basic story and gives us the legend. So it's kind of closer to the legend itself. Okay.
We do have some more comments from Haley. Would you like me to share those?
Okay.
She said, I would never have connected the tales of the camel's hump to Lamarckianism. Epigenetics is fascinating today.
Yeah, uh-huh, uh-huh. Yeah, so there are many, many different changes and developments in science.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think your snake likes to come back to your house, Aya, because it likes it there.
Yeah.
That can be, but I don't really want the snake in the house.
Yeah. So,
should we return to the?
Yeah, we can go back.
Okay, hold on.
Yeah, in India too, we have the snake. There's a snake goddess, Manasi, in India. But also we have this Jataka story, which is kind of a self-sacrifice. So this is kind of a rebirth story. Yeah.
Okay. Should I be on this slide?
Yeah. Okay. You can go down.
Okay.
Okay. That's what I was just showing you, the different translations.
Yeah. Oh, very nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so we do, you know, in the one on the left here, they use the word Märchen. Märchen is more like folktale.
Right.
So they kind of use the folktale idea in the translations, which is interesting. But it's a little bit different here in the white snake story. In the one by Shepherd. It just kind of goes back to the core story and uses the drama as kind of a background. So there's a lot of cultural overlay in both of them in these translations. So this is just a problem of translation to kind of overdetermine everything, try to explain everything in the other culture.
Well, it has sort of oracle bone type characters on the one by Shepherd on the cover.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I think the drama kind of brings it back into the Chinese culture more, mm-hmm. more thoroughly. Although he does at the beginning and the ending, he kind of says, well, in China, you have this this snake figure. He tries to explain some things, and that's kind of an overdetermination. Do we need it in translation? I don't know, right? So translation is different from sort of like what Kipling does, of course, is just to rewrite a whole the whole story or imagine a new story. But in this case,
when you translate, you can't translate every aspect of every word. That's the problem.
Right, translation and it has this difficulty. And some things you can't translate very well. Don't really, especially the transformations have kind of different connotations. You know, if you take it in the Ovid sense, then it becomes very much kind of a victimage. But if you take it in the other sense here in the white snake story, you see there's a kind of a conflict of the woman, of the snake as a woman, but also the conflict of the young man. Is he going to accept what the Buddhist monk or the Buddhist tells him to do, or is he going to believe in his wife? Right. So this is a conflict that comes out with that. So in different cultures, you would see it kind of from a different view. In the Jataka story, the next one.
Okay.
The next one.
Okay.
Yeah, you have Chinese too. I'm sorry. Okay, so here this is a Naga snake king rather than sort of the male of the transformation, and it's of course in this framework of the Buddhist transformations. So having resolved a dispute between two human kings, the Naga king helps one of the kingdoms to be successful. When he dies, he's replaced by the Bodhisattva, who, as a son of a poor family, admired the Naga king, who would come up each year from the river and take a human form to receive tributes from the human being. Kind of interesting. This is also a motif that we have in Taiwan, among the indigenous tribes, sort of the marriage to a snake who comes up from the river. So this is the Naga king who would come up each year from the river in the human form to receive tributes.
Mm-hmm.
The young boy who becomes the new Naga king at the splendid palace at the bottom of the river does not like the riches and wants to be reborn as a man. So this is sort of the transformation becomes rebirth. Better to be a man, even a man such as I was, without wealth or power, and master the ways of truth, than to dwell in luxury on the river bottom. This is not true freedom. I must discipline myself and regain a human state.
So, it's hard to imagine the luxury of dwelling at the river bottom.
Right. So in Chinese culture too, you have these palaces in the bottoms of the rivers or in the ocean. You have, you know, these kingdoms, a little bit like in the Mermaid, as done by Disney. Yeah. You have some kind of palace at the bottom of the earth. I think there was also a movie about a man who was sort of half human and half fish, or very recently. Oh. I've forgotten the title of it. Okay, then we have the dragon. Right, and the dragon, we have sort of different concepts of what the dragon is. He has this dragon palace at the bottom of the ocean or the bottoms of rivers, and it's kind of associated with the Naga king, but. Maybe we can kind of, this is also kind of a translation. I point out kind of a translation here. One of my, if you can go to the next one. This, on the left, you have what we have in folklore is a tail type. This is a Chinese collection, a Chinese tabulation. According to this is a type number 555. Oh. And this man, this Ding Nai Dong, was my teacher when I was doing my master degree in English. He was teaching folklore to us. And in his collection, we have these basic features of the tail type, the Chinese tail type. One is the kindness to the fish, okay? So it could be a fish, a snake, a turtle, and maybe it's stranded out on the earth and the human being throws it back in the lake. But then this kindness is returned, right? And maybe the person is saved from drowning, or maybe he's invited to the dragon palace. and then maybe he gets a reward at the end of a magic object, and or maybe he becomes a dragon himself. So that's the sort of the grateful dragon prince type. But we have a story here. We'll just take a look at the one on the right. That is a translation into English. And it talks about the man, Quang Rei, who is successful. He's successful in the examination. He catches a ball thrown to select a husband for the lady. And then they marry. He's on the way to take up his post. And he goes to the market. And he saves a fish there. And this fish has been caught, but he's the dragon king, actually. Mm. So the man then is thrown into the fish back in the river. But he is robbed and he's killed.
Oh.
His wife has a son and she brings him up in a monastery. But when he gets older, he goes to the emperor and he tells the emperor about his father's fate and his father saving the dragon prince. And so the emperor honors the family, and the dragon king resuscitates the man who had saved him before. So he comes back to life again. And then he returns to his wife and the former life. So this translation is kind of interesting because it brings out some, and this version in Chinese culture is interesting as well. We have sort of the association between the emperor and the dragon king at the bottom of the river. Mm-hmm. And the idea of the man coming back to life again. It's but the man who translated it added these things in the next slide. You'll see that this is some of the things that the translator added. The story of Quan Rei is a remarkable evidence of the unbounded faith which the Chinese have in the intervention of the mysterious beings to deliver men from calamities which would otherwise prove fatal to them. So when we first meet with Quan Rei, he is living with his widowed mother in a retired part of the country. His father had been dead for a long time, and Quan Rei was now the only one upon whom the fortunes of the home could be built. So there are many different Chinese cultural aspects, but should you put those into the translation? Or is that kind of over-determining the story? Sort of, you know, you give your interpretation next to the translation. There are other terminology questions in the translation. Okay, let's go to the last one here, or the last two. Okay, here we have the dragon. We have many different features of the dragon. You know, he has this, he has control of the sky space in some versions and some stories, but also the space of the ocean. We even have the dragons of the moon, right? But we also have the association of the emperor with a dragon, especially during the Qing Dynasty, when they used the dragon on the flag. We have our festivals, and during the New Year's festival and also during the Dragon Boat festivals, you have the appearance of the dragon idea. But then we have, in Western versions, we usually have kind of a diminution of the dragon figure, like he's the donor on a very small scale.
Diminished, yes, in
the movie, right,
Mulan. Yes,
yeah, that's very funny in a way. He's just a comical character.
Yes,
how he became a comical character, I don't know.
Well, in the Disney princess movies, which is what that was, there's always some kind of animal who is the familiar of the princess.
Right, right. So that comes from the folktale, the donor aspect.
Uh-huh.
It comes from that's really very, very. You've always got to have that.
Right.
Yeah, it's essential. Maybe that's something from psychology too. Commercialization, and we have the Dragon Airlines, right? I have a children's story also about the dragon becomes a teacher of calligraphy. So, you know, the dragon can be anything. can become anything. Okay, finally, I just have some questions here about translations and retellings of folktales. I think people should kind of see what kind of genre that they really want to, you know, what it is originally, and try to keep that genre as they translate it. So allegorization, like in the fables or the magic, and religious transformation, those are all different. So translation has to kind of bring that out. So do you want to make the story more foreign, or do you want to make it more friendly to your target audience, right? So that's a kind of a question that people have to deal with in translation. Yeah. And some motifs that we've been talking about, you know, can be localized. But you have to kind of understand this human-animal relationship as a continuum. Now, there's a continuous relationship between ourselves and the animals. It's not just a break, you know, that we have our animal lives, and then, we have to realize this animal aspect of ourselves, probably. Is the exotic to be made humorous? So that's what Kipling does, right? He sort of makes the foreign to be humorous.
Well, I not necessarily. I mean, I think in Kim, for instance, it takes the foreign very seriously.
Okay. Yeah. In some cases, I think, yeah, he does, especially in his poetry. Yeah.
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 I mean, he has, you know, his departmental ditties, which are very humorous poems, but usually he's laughing at the British soldiers, not the local Indian people.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in the Just So stories, he changes Solomon into Suleiman. I wonder why he did that in that last story of the Just So story. Now, this is King Solomon, but he made him into a more Arabic figure.
I mean, the Quran also tells many of the same stories that are in the Old Testament, I think, and or accepts that. So in the East, it's more likely that you would meet someone using the Arabic version.
Yeah, that's an interesting question, why he did that. So what constraints should we have on our translations? Are things that we need to think about. Okay, that's about all I have for my.
Okay, I'll stop sharing then.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, it really for the issue of translation and how similar a translation should be, it also depends on whether we're translating poetry or prose, I think, because with poetry, there are many aspects that are purely sound.
Mm-hmm.
You want to make the translation echo the sound of the original.
Yeah, I think one of the problems that we have in folklore is, if you have something that's maybe a little bit strange in another culture, how do you want to treat it? Do you want to explain it somehow? Can you do it in the translation? This is the question I've encountered over the years.
Well, I mean, even if you look at translation of things like biblical stories, what happens when you go from, say, Hebrew to an English translation is that in Hebrew, there are all these explanations. And so he called this person that because all of our names have meanings. And then the translation just can't take into account that. It doesn't translate the name into the meaning of the name. Instead, they write the sound of the name.
Yes, that they do that in Chinese too. You know, if you have a flower name or something for a girl in a novel, should you translate it, or should you use the transliteration for it, just to use the spelling of her name? So it has a different effect on the reader, you know. If you call her plum blossom,
right?
Or you talk about Mei Hua, it would be different, right?
So, which do you favor?
I don't know. I don't know. I really haven't decided for sure. But if you're going to publish it, I guess you have to decide one way or the other.
Yeah, it's also a cultural thing, because, you know, like Native American people, they used to assume that their name wasn't the sound of the name. It was the meaning of the name. So it's Sitting Bull. It's not whatever that was, you know, the sound. Yeah. But Europeans tend to expect it to be the sound.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, Aya, do you think we should call it a day?
Well, I've always been curious how you came to know Chinese so well. Could you?
How I came to, when I was studying for my master's in English, I met some Chinese people, and they from Taiwan, and they told me different stories and things of that sort. And I got interested in Chinese, and I was mostly interested in the characters at that point. The idea that you could have, you know, a character with a drawing, in effect, of water or a container or something like that. And it was something that intrigued me at the time. And then when I went to study for my PhD, I started to study Chinese in classes. So while I was doing my PhD in folklore, I was also studying Chinese. And then I was also able to have a teacher in Cantonese. So I was interested in sort of the differences between the different dialects or the different kinds of Chinese. And then for my dissertation, I decided to do field work. And so I came to Taiwan, and I was teaching English at Danjiang, up in Danshui.
Oh, yeah.
And I, on the streets, I saw this drama, and it just kind of took my interest, and I was able to get a kind of a group together that we could collect the experiences of these actors and actresses and the directors. And so I collected sort of some of their stories and got the versions of their recorded their performances, and was able to write a dissertation on that fieldwork experience. And then I, after I got the degree, then I came back to Taiwan to teach English and continued. But when I came back the second time, I came to Providence University in the middle Taiwan.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I've been in Don Shui as well. That's where I started before I came to Providence. So.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Don Shui is very beautiful with the Guanyin Mountain. Right?
Yeah.
And across the river. Yeah.
Yeah, the and sunset. It has the Hong Mao Tsen.
Yeah. You can watch the sunset and it's a beautiful place. Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. During that time it was even nicer because you could go to the little temples and you could drink tea and have talks with your friends and things like that. Nowadays it's not quite so friendly.
Is it because of COVID?
Yeah, everything's bigger now and busier.
Yeah.
A lot of high rises in Don Shui today.
Yeah.
So you came to Taizong too later.
Yes, I certainly did. And you were the head of the department.
you found an earthquake, huh?
Yes, the earthquake was quite unfortunate.
Yeah, did it kind of scare you away?
No, not me, but my mother. My mother was planning to stay quite a bit longer, and so I had to search for a nanny very quickly.
Yes, uh-huh, yeah, mm-hmm. Well, Sword had a very interesting early experience.
Yes, it didn't bother her at all. She slept through it. She had just learned to sleep through the night, and so... You know, I wore her on my person, in one of those infant carriers, and she slept through the whole thing. But my mother was in shock.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Does she remember anything?
My mother or Sword?
No, Sword. Uh-huh.
No, she doesn't really remember. I think it would be wonderful if she went to Taiwan to teach English or something like that, because I think she would remember if she were given a chance.
Yeah, uh-huh. Sort of an encounter, to bring back some things.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Well, I bet you miss the food.
Huh? Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, mm-hmm. I would love to go back, but right now international travel is so hard.
I know, yeah. So it's hard for me to get back to the States too.
So when was the last time you were in the States?
Oh, many years. I don't know. 8 maybe.
Wow.
7 or 8 years maybe.
Mm-hmm. So that's before COVID, before the pandemic.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Well, I was busy retiring and getting things ready in my retirement. And then COVID came, mm-hmm. And so I've been kind of isolated after that.
But you have a lot of friends, I remember.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. I have friends and colleagues. Taiwan has been able to control the COVID epidemic very well.
That's good.
So we can still go out to restaurants and meet people. We can still have classes.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. So maybe I hope that the success continues.
Yeah. Yes, I hope so too. And maybe in a few years we can meet in person, whether you come here or I go there.
Yeah, that would be very nice. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for your presentation.
Okay, well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk about these things that kind of interest me.
Well, I really enjoyed hearing all about it. And perhaps we can come on again sometime.
Okay, well, thank you.
All right. Bye-bye. Good night. Bye-bye.